Solange, let's just check the different mics here. I'm going to go down and just talk into the viola mic, okay? So, do you get a little bit through here? Maybe a little bit more. Maybe just check 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Let's go with that. I think that should work, okay? This is Josh's mic. Oh, yeah, that's good. Thank you. There we go. There we go. Welcome to worship. And to those of you who are gathered here in the sanctuary and those of you who are joining us online, we're glad you're with us this morning. I have some announcements I'd like to draw to your attention. These are all on the announcement sheet, but I want to highlight just a few of them. The first is that you will notice in the narthex that there is a person selling flowers for our Easter celebration. This is something we have done for the past number of years, where you purchase some flowers, they get put up front during Easter, and then after the service, you're able to take them home and enjoy them at home with you. So if that's something that you're able to help out with, the cost is $20 per plant. Just see whoever's sitting at the table there. It could be Brenda, it could be Joan, or someone else, and help us beautify our worship space for Easter. The youth group will be going to the Canadian Lutheran Anglican Youth Gathering this summer, and one of the fundraisers they're doing is called Cans for Clay. And so how this works is you can just go to any SARCAN in the city and drop off bottles and cans and just mark your bag Cans for Clay, and that's all you have to do, and then the money will get funneled to the youth group. So if you have any questions, you can speak with Carrie. Carrie, you want to give a wave here? There's Carrie. She'll answer questions about that. Some of you may remember the days when you used to bring your cans and bottles to the church, and then we took them from here. This is just trying to eliminate one of those steps and trying to keep the basement from getting flooded with cans and bottles, which sometimes happened. Our Lenten services continue on Wednesday. This will be our fifth in the series, Amazing Grace. As usual, we will have our Super Supper preceding that, and that will be starting at 5:30, but if you come a little later, that's okay. There's always soup left over. And there's a sign-up sheet for people bringing soup, and I was the first one to sign up for this week. I don't know if there's any other spaces still left open, but you might want, there is spaces left open. So I'm only gonna bring one pot of soup. So we might need some more donations of soup for this week. And then I wanted to mention a couple of things we're gonna do differently in the worship service today. So two things that are gonna happen that are different. First of all, we're not going to read the appointed gospel reading for this Sunday, which is a very long passage from the Gospel of John having to do with Jesus healing a blind man. We're not going to read it for two reasons. One, because there's also a gospel reading attached to the Lenten candle liturgy that we're going to have just a few moments here. Secondly, because I'm not going to focus on the gospel in my sermon. I am going to focus on the first reading from Samuel, 1 Samuel, and also the psalm for the day. If you are interested in hearing a good sermon about the gospel text from John, that was also the reading that was used at this most recent Lenten service. And Pastor Lynn had a very good sermon about that, and so you could always check that out online, because it's on the YouTube channel. So that's the first thing. So the gospel will not show up in its normal place. Secondly, instead of a confession of sin that we do all together spoken, today the choir is going to sing a confession of sin. It's a piece based on Psalm 51, which is often used as words of confession. So what will happen is you simply listen. The words will be put on the screen, so you can just follow along. And as you listen to the choir, we invite you to make these words your own, just as you sit there and listen. So that's sort of two things that are a little bit unusual for this morning. I have Kali Graf assisting me this morning. I thank her in advance. And I think that's all the announcements I need to make, but I'll encourage you to read carefully through your announcement sheet to not miss anything. Let's take a few moments of quiet reflection, and then we will begin.
During the 40 days of Lent, the Christian church prepares to observe the Lord's passion and resurrection. We examine ourselves as we remember the suffering and sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf. In this season of repentance and fasting, we come to terms with our mortality and need for God's mercy. The candles in this candelabra represent Jesus' life and ministry, and each week we extinguish another candle, remembering how we, the human race, rejected Jesus Christ, the light of the world.
A reading from Luke 4, 16 to 30. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in his hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine all over the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many with a skin disease in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off of the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way.
For this fourth Sunday in Lent, we extinguish four candles. We do this as we remember the people in the synagogue who reject Jesus as God's messenger. These people, filled with hatred and fear, refuse the good news of grace and forgiveness. Here, Jesus tells us what God cares about: freedom and justice for those hurting in the world. Because this mission doesn't fit their vision of what God should care about, the people refuse to believe Jesus could be God's Messiah. Consider the ways we also reject Jesus. We may reject him because we know his good news for the poor, the prisoners, the blind, and the oppressed means we would have to care for these people as well, and that would be uncomfortable. We may reject him because we want to be in control. We want Jesus to submit to our plans and desires. Instead, Jesus calls us to deny ourselves, pick up our crosses, and follow him. This offends us. Maybe we want to throw him off a cliff. Or maybe we simply ignore him and refuse to obey. But let us remember, by rejecting Jesus and what he cares about, we reject God.
Please pray with me. Holy God, we confess that we want to be in control of you. We want you to follow our agenda. We don't want to listen to Jesus. We want better food on our table, but are not concerned with those who don't have enough food on theirs. We want a promotion at work, but are not concerned that others cannot find employment to provide for their families. We don't like you disrupting our priorities by telling us we need to bring good news to the poor, the prisoners, the blind, and the oppressed. Change us, Jesus. Help us to care for the people you care about. Break our hearts for the things that break yours. Help us to listen and obey. Give us the grace to repent so we might seek first your good, true, and peaceful kingdom. Amen.
I'll invite you to stand as we sing together our gathering hymn, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us, number 789. Continue with our call to worship. Shepherd us, O God.
Open our ears to hear your calling.
Shepherd us, O God.
Open our eyes to see your care.
Shepherd us, O God.
Shear our fascination with the ways of the world.
Shepherd us, O God.
Prepare us to follow you.
We pray. Maker of visions, Spirit of truth, light of the world, you choose the least and the weak to be bearers of your good news. Rejecting those who brag of their own triumphs, you anointed your servant David to lead Israel when all he had ever done was keep his father's sheep. As we walk the uncertain paths before us, anoint us with gladness and bless us with vision. Show us the way through terror and shadow. Fill us with your light, that we may more fully be the body of Christ, bringing light to an aching, broken world. Amen. Please be seated. And now the choir will sing our song of confession, Be Merciful, O Lord. Hear these words of assurance. Christ came to lead us in paths of righteousness and to guide us through our lives. Christ is with us in times of danger and times of peace. The goodness and mercy of God are given to us each and every day of our lives. God forgives us for our failings, upholds us in love, and leads us to the place that Christ has prepared for us. Believe in your heart that God loves you and forgives you.
For our song of praise, we're going to sing a song that was a popular one at youth gatherings a little while back. So some of you will know this, and hopefully the rest of you will catch on to it pretty quick here. The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Okay, so you don't sound quite like a youth gathering yet. So the one thing that everyone can do quite easily is a clapping part that happens in the chorus. So it's the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. No, you don't clap there. So it is a little bit tricky, but you'll get it. So why don't you stand and we'll sing this all together. Let's go back to verse 1, Barry, if you don't mind. Thank you.
The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord will be my strength. He will uphold me all of my days. I am surrounded by mercy and grace. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Please join me in the prayer of the day. Discerner of hearts, You look beneath our outward appearance and see your image in each of us. Banish in us the blindness that prevents us from recognizing truth, so we may see the world through your eyes and with the compassion of Jesus Christ, who redeems us. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from 1 Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long are you going to grieve over Saul? I have rejected him as king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and get going. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem because I have found my next king among his sons." "How can I do that?" Samuel asked. "When Saul hears of it, he'll kill me." "Take a heifer with you," the Lord replied, "and say, 'I have come to make a sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will make clear to you what you should do. You will anoint for me the person I point out to you." Samuel did what the Lord instructed. When he came to Bethlehem, the city elders came to meet him. They were shaking with fear. "Do you come in peace?" they asked. "Yes," Samuel answered. "I've come to make a sacrifice to the Lord. Now make yourselves holy, then come with me to the sacrifice." Samuel made Jesse and his sons holy and invited them to the sacrifice as well. When they arrived, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, "That must be the Lord's anointed right in front." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Have no regard for his appearance or stature, because I haven't selected him. God doesn't look at things like humans do. Humans only see what is visible to the eyes, but the Lord sees into the heart." Next, Jesse called for Abinadab, who presented himself to Samuel, but he said, "The Lord hasn't chosen this one either." So Jesse presented Shammah, but Samuel said, "No, the Lord hasn't chosen this one." Jesse presented seven of his sons to Samuel, but Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord hasn't picked any of these." Then Samuel asked Jesse, "Is that all of your boys?" "There is still the youngest one," Jesse answered, "but he's out keeping the sheep." "Send for him," Samuel told Jesse, "because we can't proceed until he gets here." So Jesse sent and brought him in. He was reddish brown, had beautiful eyes, and was good looking. The Lord said, "That's the one. Go, anoint him." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him right there in front of his brothers. The Lord's spirit came over David from that point forward. Then Samuel left and went to Ramah. Here ends the reading.
Our psalm for today is Psalm 23, and we're going to read it responsibly. Lord, you are my shepherd.
There is nothing I shall want.
Fresh and green are the pastures
where you give me repose.
Near restful waters you lead me
to revive my drooping spirit.
You guide me along the right path.
You are true to your name.
If I should walk in the valley of darkness,
no evil would I fear.
You are there with your crook and your staff.
With these you give me comfort.
You have prepared a banquet for me
in the sight of my foes.
My head you have anointed with oil.
My cup is overflowing.
Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me
all the days of my life.
In the Lord's own house shall I dwell
forever and ever. A reading from Ephesians. You were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So live your life as children of light. Light produces fruit that consists of every sort of goodness, justice, and truth. Therefore, test everything to see what's pleasing to the Lord, and don't participate in the unfruitful actions of darkness. Instead, you should reveal the truth about them. It's embarrassing to even talk about what certain persons do in secret, but everything exposed to the light is revealed by the light. Everything that is revealed by the light is light. Therefore it says, "Wake up, sleeper, get up from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Here ends the reading.
So normally, this is where we would hear the gospel reading, but you already heard this gospel reading from Luke at the beginning of the service. And the connection with the message today is the idea of rejecting that which you don't understand or see to be from God. But that's all I'm going to say on that. Now we're going to invite the Sunday school children to head upstairs for their Sunday school time. Please pray with me. Gracious God, as we reflect on the scriptures for this morning, may we see with your eyes so that we might understand with your heart. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. The 23rd Psalm is a familiar psalm to most. And it is so beloved because of its imaginative and comforting imagery. In order to hear it with fresh ears today, I chose a different translation. So you might have noticed that a few of the phrases were worded a little differently. The translation I used is called the Psalms, an inclusive language version based on the Grail translation from the Hebrew. So this was something that was produced by some women scholars in England beginning in the 60s, and then it was revised again in the 80s. So we're going to go through the 23rd Psalm a little bit, and I'm going to try and point out some things that might be new or interesting to you. And hopefully you will be able to hear this psalm anew today. So what I'm going to first of all begin with is to tell you that this psalm has an interesting connection with baptism. And I don't think I've ever explored that connection in the past. But we can see that the 23rd Psalm's influence on an understanding of what baptism is all about can be found in the iconography of baptistries, that is, in the artwork that was painted on the walls of baptistries in the early church. So baptistries was a separate building from the primary worship space, and it had to have running water, so most of these baptistries had water that would come in and then go out. They were often pools that were deep enough that you could stand sort of up to your waist in them. And they were decorated all around the periphery. So we have a picture from one of these baptistries. This is from a house church. So it wasn't a separate building, but it was a separate room in this house church. And it was a font that was created in the 3rd century Syrian congregation at Dura Europus. So Barry, you want to go to the next slide? Whoops. Nope, go back. Go back. Oh, what happened to them? Maybe I didn't put them in. Maybe I put the wrong thing there. It might be, Jim, that I saved the wrong file. Does it look like there's a picture of artwork with a little red circle around it? Probably not. I probably messed up. Now Jim's shaking his head. I messed up. So you'll just have to hear my explanation of what this looks like. Doesn't look like much. It's just a simple line drawing of a shepherd with a sheep around his neck. But because it's on this house church wall, from archaeological dig, we know that this was an important symbol for the early church, an important symbol of baptism. I will, at some point, I'll show it to you. It's pretty interesting. Or you could just Google it. Just write Dura Europus and baptistry, and you'll find it, I think. So, all right. So, how is the 23rd Psalm connected with baptism? That's the question we want to ask right at this point. Well, it begins with these opening lines where you have, Lord, you are my shepherd. There's nothing I shall want. Fresh and green pastures where you give me repose. And then this line, near restful waters you lead me to revive my drooping spirit. So here we have a picture of a shepherd moving the flock onto waters which are safe, clear, and accessible. And the result of such water is to be revived, that is, to be given new life in a sense. And in this case, the verb revive in its original Greek suggests that the shepherd is always looking out for our welfare, repeatedly turning us in the right direction, and a reminder that baptism is only the beginning of a journey on which we shall be challenged again and again to follow Christ's lead. So the image of the water being there, a place to be revived, but you don't stay there. Why don't you stay there? Because in a nomadic economy, where pastures are overgrazed and watercourses change with the season, sheep cannot remain in the same place or they will die. So the life of faith is a life of change amidst challenge, but this change or transformation is guided by one who has our best interests in mind, that is, the shepherd. So we have this image of, yes, we come to this place where there is water that revives us, but the shepherd will also lead us to other pastures where we can continue to grow and live and thrive. So baptism, likewise, is a beginning, but it is not the end of our journey of faith. The concept of journey comes up in the next verses. You guide me along the right path. You are true to your name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. There, you are there with your crook and your staff, and with these you give me comfort. So notice we have a pathway, and it's the shepherd who's guiding us, but this is journey language now, right? And if I should walk in the valley of darkness, so if this is where we're going through at a particular time, I will not fear evil. Why? Because you are with me. Now, what's interesting in this little section is that there is a good chance that this is implying a liturgical procession, which would have been led by the anointed sovereign, the king. And he would have been leading with a crook and a staff, or perhaps an orb and a scepter. But he would have been leading with items that indicated that he was the leader and had God's authority. And so then this idea is God provides us with leaders who will lead us in a way that will give us life and provide us with support and comfort and protection. Much like a king should be, right? The kings of Israel, what they should have been. So here we have this picture then of sort of a scene of worship. And of course, the Psalms were the worship book of the ancient Israelites. And so it doesn't surprise us to find pictures of worship services scattered throughout the Psalms, because that's what they were used for. So the connection with us is that we share in this royal priesthood that is given to people who are anointed by God, and we share that through our baptism. So our baptism connects us with Christ, and in that connection, then we walk with Christ in this procession, led by Christ, so that we can go in the right direction, even in our worship. And then to further the picture of elements of worship that early Christians picked up on, these next lines, you've prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing. So we remember that in ancient Israel, kings were anointed rather than crowned. That was how they were indicated as God's chosen ones. So this is a picture not only of a shepherd caring for his sheep, because we also know that shepherds would use oil to tend to the wounds, scrapes and cuts on sheep and so forth, but it also was a symbol of God designating one as chosen to lead. In baptism, we too had water poured on our heads and our foreheads were anointed with oil, marking us as chosen by God. Chosen to be part of God's mission in this world, a mission of goodness and kindness, a mission to be leaders in showing grace as we have been shown grace. So baptism has been the ritual that marked full inclusion in the worshiping body. And it was after their baptism that converts to Christianity in the early centuries were allowed to stay in the worship service when communion took place. So in those days, what would happen is there would be an opening section where there was a gathering, some psalms sung, and so forth, and then a passage would be read from Scripture, and then a sermon would be given, and then the non-baptized were excused, and when it continued with communion. So then on Easter Sunday morning, when the baptisms took place for the most part in the early church, then these people would be baptized in this rather elaborate ritual and then proceed from the baptistry into the main sanctuary where for the first time they could celebrate communion with the rest of the congregation, and it was a joyous occasion. So these words that we hear here about my cup overflowing is an image, I think, of the cup of communion that is abundant. And so baptism led to the banquet, we might say, of God's grace, even as surrounded by hostile forces, right? Because that's part of the line, right? You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. So, two for us. Baptism leads to the banquet of God's grace, even as we are surrounded by hostile forces, that is, those evil influences that would lead us astray and eventually seek to destroy us. But we remain in the presence of the Good Shepherd, and the abundance of grace overflows. The cup of forgiveness offered at communion will never run dry. Thus, we can be assured of remaining in God's presence forever. We will dwell in God's house forever and ever, as the psalm states. The blessings of God, goodness and kindness, will be with us always. Such a comforting and reassuring image. But where did David, who tradition names as the composer of this psalm, where did David come up with these metaphors for God's relationship with us? David knows these things because David was a shepherd himself. We may have an image of shepherds as important people in biblical times because partly they show up all the time throughout Scripture, and partly because Jesus refers to himself as the Good Shepherd. But there is another message in using a shepherd as a symbol for God, and to find it, we have to look at the story of David as a young shepherd boy. And this is the story from Samuel that you heard today. So, as I pointed out, kings in those days were anointed rather than crowned. And so Samuel is told by God to go to Jesse, the house of Jesse in Bethlehem, and there he is to anoint the new king, because Saul is no longer going to be king, or his kingship will come to an end. And what we see in this passage here is a powerful word about the painful after effects of the failure of leadership. At the beginning of the story, God admonishes Samuel, asking him, "How long will you grieve about Saul?" The reference to grief signifies sorrow, a deep disappointment of what could have been. There were high expectations for Saul, but these have been eroded away by this point in the story. Hope has been replaced by fear, and even Samuel fears for his life when God asks him to anoint Saul's successor. And then God has to tell Samuel, well, look, here's what you can do. You can go and say you're going to offer a sacrifice, and this is why you're going to Bethlehem, and take a cow with you so that the suspicions aren't raised. Because God knows that Saul already is acting very much as a paranoid ruler. So God's position is clear. No leader, no matter how mighty he or she thinks they are, is immune to losing their position of power and influence. Instead, God calls upon Samuel to take heart and do what prophets are supposed to do, to anoint those whom God has chosen. From the divine response, it's clear that despite the recent failure of leadership of Saul, Samuel should not give up hope in finding a leader who truly can lead in the way that God intends. But there's a surprise in this story. The chosen one, the anointed one, is not whom one would expect it to be. It is not the eldest of Jesse's sons, not even the second in line, nor one of the seven sons who in quite dramatic fashion are paraded before Samuel, but found not to be the chosen one. When Samuel, after this whole parade of sons have gone before him, despondently asks if there is anyone else, Jesse finally remembers David. Oh yeah, David, the eighth son, the youngest of his brothers. This king-to-be is also not the one with the most imposing stature. When Samuel first arrives, the first son he sees, Eliab, he goes, oh no, that's gotta be the guy. Because he was a man's man or something like that, right? He looks like a leader. And not that one. Well, maybe this guy, he kind of looks like a leader, yeah. Then you get to David, and the best thing you can say about David is he's handsome. That's about the best thing. He's reddish in appearance, which I'm not quite sure what that means. I don't know if that means he's sunburnt because he's out in the sun all day or whatever, but he certainly doesn't seem to have an imposing stature. So he does not look like a king in terms of societal norms. He's also the youngest, right? Samuel reminds the people, God does not see as humans see. They look on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. So, to learn that David is a shepherd boy, who most likely, like shepherds in that time, was found in the fields and looked down upon and even viewed with contempt, is to understand that God looks on the heart and not on outward appearances. David is an unlikely character for a leadership position, at least in the eyes of the people there. I mean, Jesse hardly even remembered him. Surely it can't be David. And we have to remember, right, that like we hear all these stories about David afterwards. We forget what it must have been like in those early days. This is before the story with David and Goliath, by the way. This is even before that event happens. So David is literally just a shepherd boy, out in the fields, doing the work that is sort of the bottom of the pile. That's David. Now, later in the story of David, after he has defeated Goliath and befriended Saul's son, Jonathan, David has to flee from the paranoid and jealous King Saul. You remember King Saul even throws a spear at him, right? David finds himself on the margins of society together with the rabble-rousers, the malcontents, and the disenfranchised. We read in Samuel chapter 22, everyone who was in distress and everyone who was in debt and everyone who was discontented gathered to David, and he became captain over them. So here on the fringes of society is the next leader of Judah to be found. A worthy predecessor for the Messiah who will be born in a manger and whose first visitors are the shepherds who were outside in the field. The theme of unlikely leaders is found throughout the Hebrew scriptures. For example, Moses stutters and he has blood on his hands, and yet his face is said to shine when he encounters God. Also in the book of Judges, one finds numerous unlikely leaders, as evident in the left-handed Ehud. I mean, left-handedness in those days was seen as a curse, right? Deborah, who leads the people despite being a woman, which was highly unusual in those days, and Jephthah, who was the son of a prostitute. All unlikely leaders. So in the end, this is what we can say. It doesn't matter where you've come from, and it doesn't matter whether or not you are highly regarded by those around you. If God chooses you and empowers you, all that matters is that you carry out God's mission faithfully. This is what makes for a good king in ancient Israel, and this is what we should all aspire to as anointed, spirit-filled followers of our good shepherd. The one who is despised by many, disregarded by many, misunderstood by many, but also the one who changed the world. Paul reminds us in his letter to the Ephesians, you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So live your life as children of light. Light produces fruit that consists of every sort of goodness, justice, and truth. May you follow the Good Shepherd. May you live your life as a child of light. And may you know that God has chosen you for a special purpose and given you what you need to carry that out. Thanks be to God. Amen. For our hymn of the day, we're going to sing the hymn, Shepherd Me, O God. And how we're going to do this is the congregation will sing the refrain, and Joshua is going to sing the verses. I'll invite you to stand and we'll sing Shepherd Me, O God, number 780.
Shepherd me, O God, be my Lord.
Let us confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated for a time of prayer. The end of each petition will be, Good Shepherd, hear our prayer. You, O God, the Good Shepherd, lead your people along still waters. You have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world as the Lamb who redeems your people from their sin. Jesus has become the light that illumines the darkness, allowing us to learn what is pleasing in your sight. You know the thoughts of our hearts before we speak. Hear us then as we utter this prayer.
As you lead us along paths of righteousness, give to us the clarity of vision to discern the way we should go. Our spirits are eager to be faithful in Christ's name. The problems that confront us impel us to act. When we hold back for fear that we will fail, may your Spirit infuse us with the courage to proceed. Good Shepherd.
The issues that face us often do not lend themselves to simple solutions. May your rod and staff comfort us with the promise of your presence. There are many who hunger for sustenance and thirst after their own redemption from the demons that enslave them. May we take from your table the bread that will nourish them with the truth of your gracious salvation. May we lift to their lips the cup that holds the promise of new life. Good Shepherd, hear our prayer.
Your goodness and mercy dwell with us throughout our lives. As members of your household, we inherit the promise of your rest. Help us in times of reflection to discover the truth, and in times of action to be more decisive and deliberate. Good Shepherd, hear our prayer.
As we pass through valleys that await us, may we be led by your radiance and refreshed by the promise that you shepherd us still. Good Shepherd,
hear our prayer.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Loving Shepherd, gentle Savior, we give you thanks this day for rest in green pastures, for refreshment beside still waters, for health and wholeness for our souls. As we rejoice in your goodness and mercy, we offer you our gifts this day. Through our offering, may others be blessed, as we have been blessed from your hand. Amen.
I invite you to stand for our sending hymn, When You Go From Here. Receive this blessing. Open your eyes and your heart to the light of God, even in the presence of your enemies. For the vision of God's light is found in what is good and right and true. Go forth as children of the light. In the name of the one who is the maker of visions, Spirit of truth, light of the world. Amen.
Go in peace, inspired by Christ, to love and serve.
Thanks be to God.